Morning.
Let me see the presentation. Today we are going to see the presentation of Java, JSP and JavaScript.
Yes, I am Rajavel. Yes, I am past 4 years I am working in a Clicker application. Let me start with Java. Okay.
How many of them familiar with Java? More than half. I think 75%. JSP? 25%. JavaScript?
50. Okay, fine.
Okay, this most of them knows Java is an object oriented, then platform independent. What is object oriented? C++.
I think you may study C++, correct?
How many of them knowing about C++? C++? Almost. Okay. C++ also object oriented and Java also object oriented. Is there is any difference between this both, or both are different? Pointers. Java don't have pointers. Then anything else? The platform, Java gives the feature of platform independent. And anything else? Is it C++ purely object oriented? Why? Sorry? In C++, we can write C++ program without creating a class. So it means that without creating an instance, that is the object, we can use any methods or functionalities. So it violating the pure object-oriented principles. So Java, it is a pure object-oriented principles. Okay. And it is simple if you know the basic programming concepts. And then secure, it has a built-in security, like public encryptions. We can use this, the encryptions, all the security features to make your application more secure. And then multi-threading, it gives the feature of multi-threading. We can do multiple process for a single program. Then high performance. What is high performance? It's like gives the just in time comparisons. Okay. How the platform independent works? What is the platform independent? The code has to be run on all the platform, like whether it may be the Windows or Unix or Mac, whatever it is. So how it works? Like if you write any Java program, when you compile, it will convert into bytecode. It is the main feature is bytecode. That is the strength of Java, bytecode. The bytecode, for example, if you are developing any Java program in Windows, after you compile, you will get the bytecode. That bytecode you can execute in any operating system. For example, Unix, you can execute the same code which is running on Windows. Okay, that is a bytecode works. So who is running that bytecode? JVM. Okay, Java Virtual Machine. It is the one executing your bytecode. Okay, that is a class. Bytecode is a class file. So this is how platform independent works. Okay, let me start with some basic terms we used to almost we use it in a Java programming. First one is the object. What is the object? In real time, you consider don't go with Java. Every chair, pen, book, table, car, everything is a object. Each object have its own state as well as behavior. For example, if you take it as a camera, camera has their own state. What are the states? Color of the camera, and then the resolutions, the optical zoom. So these are some state behavior. What is the behavior of a camera? A click photo, take video, stop the recording. So these are some behavior. Okay, so likewise Java also same, the object have a state as well as the behavior. That is a object. Next one is a class. What is a class? Class is a, it's like integration of like attributes as well as the member variable as well as member functions. That is a class. Okay. It describes the state and behavior. Okay. And method. Just what we are just telling about the behavior. The behavior we can achieve through method or function. Okay. Next one is a instant variable. Instant variable defines the state. Okay. So what we like mentioned, the color, the size, everything it was is a state. We can just achieve through instant variable. Okay. This is a basic term we are almost used in a Java. Okay. Before getting into Java programming, you have to keep some important points in your mind. Okay. The first one is a case sensitive. So many of them knows about the case sensitive. It's like it has a, it gives the case sensitive, like hello with H capital, hello with H small letter is a different meaning. Okay. As well as second one, class name. The class name, the most of the people when you are starting on a Java programming, they are not following the standard of Java's coding standard. So in Java, class name should be how it should be. The first character of each word should be capital. For my class, M is a capital, C is a capital. So that is a naming format. And then method, how the method should be. Other than first character of first word, the same as class name. Okay. Then program file name. The program file name should be same as class name, public class name. Is it mandatory? How many of them telling it is mandatory? The class name and then program file name should be same. Okay. Just actually are using ID. Which ID you are using? Eclipse. So that's why you are not that much familiar with what is the difference. What ID, when you are using IDE, simply we used to run, when you run button it will give the results. But actually what is happening? The Java code is compiling. The ordinary, if you are using terminal, what you used to do? You have to give Java C. What is that? That is a file name. When you are creating a file name, when you compile, the name of the class is created a class file. For example, I having a one file, my file.java, but inside I have one class. The class name is my class. The class name is my class, but file name is my file.java. How to compile? Java C my file.java. But after compilation, it gives the result as my class.class. That is a class file it gives. So after, how to execute Java, you have to give the class name, my class. So we can give the different naming in file as well as class. But when we are using in IDE, we are not much familiar with this case. But most of the IDEs gives the warning, the name should be same as file name based on his compatibility. That IDE compatibility. Okay. Good. This is the some small tips. Then simple program. Like Java program start with execution. Now execution start with public static void main method. Okay. It is having a argument, that is a string arguments. Okay. String array arguments. Okay. Okay. In this program, the class name is hello world app. Okay. The execution start with main method. In main method, I am creating an object for the same class. The object name is hello. And in this class having one member function, the member function is say hello. Simply it will print the system.out.println. What, you know anything about system.out.println? It is used for printing the statement. Okay. Then after just simple one method is there, just simply print the one statement, that is hello. In main I am creating an object, using that object I have created the, just I am simply invoking the method, the member function, say hello. So after execution of this, it will simply print hello, that's all. Okay, what is the purpose of creating an object? Is it mandatory? Actually the thing is that I am in a same class, but the method say hello also in the same class. So is it mandatory to invoke through object? What is happening actually when you are creating object? This you are creating on class, you have created an object. What is the internal structure if you are doing this? The first line of main function, what is happening when you write this statement? Okay, so actually what is happening internally, you are creating an object, creating a class. The class has n number of variables as well as n number of methods. Okay, it's the memory is not created for the class, correct? Simply it is there. When you are creating an object using new keyword, it is creating a memory for a class to share, to access their members. Okay, so if I creating one object is hello, the hello has the memory space for accessing these members in a class, hello world app. Again I am creating another object, what is happened? It is sharing the same memory space which is created existing, already created. No, when creating another object, it is creating another memory space for the another object. So likewise, how many objects you are creating for the class, each one sharing their own memory space. Okay, you understood? Okay. I think I no need to execute this program in IDE. Do you want? I will go with some other program.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, where is the memory for the method allocated? At the time of creating an object.
Yeah, the object is for accessing that particular method. Sorry, actually it is creating at the time of class, but the memory space, the separate memory space to access the particular method is created at the time of creating an object. Understood, na? For example, if I am simply having a method sum having a two variable a plus b. So the functionality is going to be same for all the objects. So that is created, but according to the memory space, but is different. Sure, the memory space for accessing that particular method is different. You can exactly feel the difference at the time of static access modifier. You come to know the exact difference. You can feel it. What is the object space? What is the class like sharing their own member functions? This is access modifiers. Okay. Before getting to access modifier, I'll let you know just two terms, that is package and then subclass. Package is a simple folder, it have all related classes, that is a package. Okay. Then subclass, the class is derived from another class, that is a, what is that? Subclass. Just I tell you about subclass more in detail in object oriented principles. That is the inheritance. It's a reusing the property of existing classes. That is a inheritance. That is a subclass. Okay. For example, I am having one class having a two method, addition, division, multiplication. Three method I am having. The same functionality I am going to use it for some other class. So is it no need to recreate the same methods again? Simply we can reuse it. So that is a subclass. Okay. So the class which is created newly, it is going to use the property of existing class. Okay. Access modifier. In Java have four access modifiers, that is a public, private, protected and the no modifier. no modifier is a, you are not mentioning any modifiers like protected, public, private. If you are leave the space, you are not mentioning anything, that is a no modifier. Okay. Public, it can be accessed inside a class as well as inside a packages and then subclasses. And rest of the world, it means that from anywhere you can access it, the public access modifier. Okay. Then protected, protected other than the rest of the world, like they can use, they can access their own member, that is a class, inside class, packages as well as subclasses. No modifier, only within a class as well as packages. Private, it is a only within a class. I will give you one example. Okay. Your name?
Mohit.
Huh? Mohit. Where are you from?
Kalyan.
Okay, but where you study? Okay, fine. Then what is your father name?
Lakshman.
Lakshman. Okay, good. What is your girlfriend name? Huh? You don't have girlfriend. Huh? Let me discuss after. Oh, you want to, don't want to discuss. That is a, what is that? Protected. It's not private. So if his close friend asks, definitely he will disclose. Correct? Even if he won't disclose in close friend also, it may be. Okay. If I am asking his girlfriend mobile number, will him disclose? Never. That is a private. So likewise, it works. Okay. Based on the access scope, we can access the each modifiers. Understood, na? Just I am asking about understanding about the access modifier. Okay. Okay. Fine. Okay. Let me see one example for access modifier. Okay. I am created one class, the class name is access modifier. In this class having four variable, first one is a public, the name of the variable pub, pub, private, that is a PIV, another one is a protected, PROT, then last one is a DEF, that is a no modifier. Okay. I am accessing, I am creating one like member function, the member function name is display, simply it will display the value of each variables if I assign any values. Okay. Let me discuss what is the meaning of this. Okay. We will leave now about this keyword. Okay. In main method, I am created object for the same class. Using that object, I am assigning the value for each variables. Okay. The value I am assigning as 10. Okay. Then using the same object, I am invoking the method display. What is happening when you invoke any method using object, but implicit object is passing through the same method, that implicit object name is called this. Using this keyword, you can invoke, you can refer the invoking object. So which one is the invoking object here? AM. So but indirectly I am using AM through the keyword this. So again I can access the variable, correct? So simply I am printing the value of each. So definitely it will print the value as it is. As we seen, in same class we can access all the modifiers, correct? Okay. I am creating another class, the class name is subclass. In the subclass, what I am doing? I am creating instance for, it's the same class? No. Here I am derived the property of existing class. This is a syntax for using inheritance. Okay. The keyword is extends. Using the keyword extends, you can inherit the property of another class. Here the access modifier is a base class. It's going to derive the property of all base class into subclasses. Okay. The subclass going to access all the methods, all the variables other than private. We can't able to pass, we can't able to access the private modifiers because private is belongs to the same class. Okay, okay. So I'm accessing the assigning a value 5, 5, but I have put the as like initialization of private as into comment, so it will work. And simply for knowing purpose, I put it in a comment. Okay, okay. If that statement appear without comment, what will happen? It will error. Private is not in a scope of the subclass. Okay, AM display. What it will do? It will again invoke the. Okay, but in this method, I am using second statement. What is second statement? I am accessing the private. Will it give error? Why? Will it give error? How many of them telling it gives error? It will not give error because display is belongs to the same class. So it can access their own private member. Okay? So that's why it's possible. But it will give the default value what it has. By default it may be 0. Okay? So it will print the value as 0 instead of 5. So we are not assigned. So remaining variable it will print value is 5. Okay? Yeah.
Modifier is no modifier does not share with subclass, but
is it a subclass? Yeah, it is subclass, but it is in the same package. Okay, so likewise I have created in my ID, so it is in the same package, so that's why it works. But when you comes to it is a so subclass is gives the scope of its subclass privileges as well as protected. In the under the protected roof it can access their members. Okay, understood na? Okay, if I created the subclass as in a different package, I can't able to access it. Okay, do you want to see the examples? It's the same program. Okay, but here instead of display I am having some other methods. Okay, what are the methods? Simply like I am created sum. Actually I have created this for method overloading. I let you explain later. Okay, let me see the non access modifiers. Okay, these are some non access modifiers. There is a final. The final is a, what is that? It's prevent its content to modify. Okay, that is a final. If you are declare a class is final, we cannot extend the particular class. So it mean that we can't reuse, we can't inherit. Okay, that is a final. Then abstract. What is the abstract? Like basic term abstract, like simple overview of anything, that is a abstract view. Okay, that is abstract. I explain you later how abstracts works in Java. Next, static. Static modifier are used to create a class variables. Actually already I explained like what is static. The static here is that when you are mention any variable is static, that static variable or method is belongs to the class, not belongs to any object. For example, you are mention the variable, for example stat is a variable. Okay, you declare that variable is static, so that variable will share the property to all the objects. For example, that variable is created memory space for only one for all the objects. All object has to share the same memory space. So what, how it will work then? It is on static variable. Okay, the value is 10. Okay, I am created object 1, object 2, okay? If it is not static, so what will happen? Each object having their own space for accessing their own value. It may be 10 or it may be 20. Whatever you are changing belongs to the particular object, it will not reflect to another object. But here, that is not the same. So, every object sharing the same space. So, through one object, so it is like common, it is a copy for all the objects, okay. So, if you want to access this space, we cannot access through object because it is not belongs to object. If you want to access the variable, you have to access through class name, okay. So, it has to be accessed through class name, that is a static. Next one is a strict FP, that is a strict floating point, okay. When you want to get the exact result of floating point, you can use this modifier, okay. Next one is a synchronized. The synchronized is used at the time of multi-threading. So, the multi-threading is, so many thread simultaneously runs at the same time. So, there is a chance the particular code have a like not a deadlock, like concurrent access, the chance of losing the data, okay, inconsistency will happen. So, for avoiding that, we have to keep the particular code as a synchronized. So, if it is the particular code is synchronized, the particular block can be accessed one by one, okay. Last one is a volatile. In volatile, we can use it in a same threading, thread concepts, okay. It is changed unexpectedly by other part of the code. Now, volatile is like it will get keep on changing. So, it keep on changing in the sense, so any like for if you are using in multi-threading, okay, all it is shared by all the thread. So, multiple thread will work simultaneously.
Yeah.
Which one? Strict float point. For example, if you are declared on variable is float, we can't get the exact floating value. So, for example, floating value in the sense, I am having a 4 variable float. I am doing the same calculation in different methods or something. So, there is a chance to have different values in a particular expression based on number of floating point occurs, it will get change, the variable result may, the expression result may be differ. For example, in a fraction point, not in the integer part, it is a fraction point, there is a chance to have a difference in a big expressions. To avoid this difference, we can use strict floating point. It gives the same results for all the particular expression in all the cases. Next one is a type of variables. These are three type of variable: local variable, class variable, and then class variable, instant variable. Okay. The local variable, if you are declare any variable inside a block, that is a local variable. The scope of the variable is within that block. What is the instant variable? Instant variable, the scope will be within the class. The static, what is static? All instants can share it, okay. The instant variables belongs to the particular instant, okay. For example, I put A. For the particular instant obj1, only can access this A. obj2 cannot access this value, but they can access their own variable, that is a instant variable. Static like stat, that variable, it shares by all the objects, okay. This is a program about the variable type. I have declared two variable, one is a member variable, another one is a static, okay. I have created the object for the same class, that is var, By using that, I am initializing the value to both. First one, for first initialization, member variable I have initialized through object. For second one, stat, that is belongs to the static. If you are accessing within a class, you can access the variable without name of the class. If you are accessing outside, you have to mention the class name. So that's why here I am not mentioning the class name. The proper way is that you have to mention with class name dot the name of the variable. Okay. Then I am simply printing the value of that static. After I am invoking the member function, the member function simply printing one value, that is member variable using this keyword, then static. It will print both, the static will print the same value and the instant variable also same. For example, if I am, okay, in that print value, I have created one variable that is local. Is it possible to access the local variable inside the main? No, because that is local variable, it has their own scope within that method. So there is a local, the instant variable. That, so it, here it was within a class, so instant variable can access anywhere within the class as well as static also. But it has to access, instant variable has to access through object, static has to access through the class name. Okay. Okay, I have to raise this question before starting simple program, but you may not, you also may have doubts. Now you may clarify these doubts in your mind itself. Why the main method in Java is public static void main? Just simple first one, void, because it is not returning any value, so void. Then static, why it is static? For if you want to start, if you want to invoke any method, you can access through, if it is not static, it definitely it has to access through object. So the program execution is start with the main, so we cannot, before that we can't create object. So that's why the method is static. Then public, it can access from outside the class, so that's why it is public. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. It is returns to JVM. Okay. 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 Thank you. So it's like JVM to what? What it is returning? Execute, that execution flow is returning to JVM. Okay. Fine. So just you can note this point also, like it's like he is telling like why does it not mean like it's not returning any value, it is, it mean that it returning to JVM, the virtual machine, that execution flow is getting returned to JVM. Okay, it's correct na? That is okay, fine. Then object oriented principles. In object oriented principle, we are going to discuss about the four thing: abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance, and then polymorphism. Okay. Okay. What is abstraction? Hiding the definitions. That is the internal functionality of an object. Okay. What is the need of hiding the internal functionality? So it's like it is not giving the definition for an method. That is a abstract. When the case will arise? In what case you will declare a class is abstract? If you don't want to declare object of a class, so if you don't want to declare a class object for the class, what is the need of creating the class? Basically, it is for inheritance. So inheritance, okay, you are inheriting. So it is not like without abstract also I can inherit. Why it is abstract? Sorry?
Reusing the code so that the common code can be put in another class.
Okay.
So the same we can do it in ordinary class, correct? Just whatever you are explaining is ordinary class. If I am creating a without abstract, I am creating one class. I am deriving the same class. Whatever you are explaining, like I can use this, reuse the same code. What it is written in a base class, I can reuse it. Why it is abstract? That's my like. That is the actual, exactly, yeah.
You might also have some proprietary algorithm or something that you might not want to open it in there too.
No, actually, the thing is that what he said was, for example, I am taking one example is like a vehicle, okay? Vehicle is an abstract class. What vehicle actually do? It can drive, it can like change the gear. It depends on the vehicle. If without gear, we cannot do the changing the gear. So likewise, but each functionality will be differ for the sub level. For if it is two wheeler, if it is a four wheeler, the brand is differ. Okay, the riding a vehicle will be differ, correct? Will it be same? The base level, the implementation, the definition of the particular behavior will be differ, but it have the behavior. Each vehicle definitely have the behavior of stop and start. Yeah. Sorry? Sorry, I am not getting you. Okay. No, that actually, yeah, actually the thing is that in here what I am explaining is you are telling like it is defining about the interface, yeah, interface, and it will same for abstract like also, but one difference is if particular in inheritance what for interface, what will happen, whatever you can't give any definition for any method. You have to give a definition in the sub level for interface. The abstract also you can create the same way like interface without any definitions you can give. So it means that all functionality will be get differ in sub level. So that defines abstract and interface. In abstract have some other features. If you want to share the particular behavior in all the sub level, we can use abstract. Okay, for example, each vehicle may have the same behavior for the particular, so behavior will be same. So what you have to do, you no need to repeat it in all the subclasses, correct? So what we can do, we can put that implementation in abstract class, that code can be shared by all sub level classes. Okay, anything else? Okay, what is he? Some of them like may confuse with interface. What is interface, correct? Or everyone knows interface? Anybody not aware of interface? Okay, fine. So that is a abstraction. Then encapsulation. Encapsulation is like the wrapping up of data in a single unit. That is a encapsulation. The best example is class. Class is the wrapping the member variable and member function. Then inheritance. What is inheritance? As already we seen, it is reusing the behavior of existing class. That is a base class. Okay. Just do you want to give any explanation in inheritance? I think we have seen an example. Okay, then polymorphism. What is polymorphism? Actually, it is a what? Many?
Many forms of the same.
If you want to define the same object in many form, we can use, that is a feature of polymorphism. It has two. One is the compile time, another one is the runtime polymorphism. We can call it as overloading and overriding. Let me see in deep of each. Okay. For abstract, we have to use the keyword abstract. Another thing, we cannot be instantiated, but we can be sub class. It means that we can reuse it. Okay. It's like a sample, the syntax for defining a abstract class. Okay. So based on our requirement, it may or may not be having a abstract method. If the method is abstract, it means that that method don't have a definitions. Okay. Abstract method. So as I said, na, like a vehicle. If you take it as a vehicle, have the behavior of start and stop. Okay. So it's abstract. So we cannot in vehicle itself, without knowing which vehicle, we cannot without defining a vehicle, we cannot defining a its behavior. Correct. It's like abstract level vehicle. So when you subclassed, so it means that the two wheeler, the particular vehicle name. So it means that we can give a definition for the particular behavior.
So can we override an abstract method?
Abstract method?
Can it be overridden by a subclass?
Override in the sense like?
As in say you define a subclass.
Okay. Yeah, we can do.
It can be overridden.
Yeah. So like actually the simple example, one is an abstract level I am giving a shape. Shape is, we cannot, without knowing which shape is, we cannot find the area of the shape as well as we cannot draw. Correct. When you subclassed like with a rectangle, triangle and circle, we know the shape. How to calculate the area of the shape as well as how to draw. Correct. So that is a example. You understood, no? Subclass, sorry, abstract class. You have any doubts in abstract class or any questions? The encapsulation, we don't need to give an example. Like it defines the class. Okay. Another one is the next one, inheritance. Inheritance, reusing the property of existing class. Okay. For inheritance, we have to use the keyword that is extends. Okay. So you have to extends the property of the base class. Here the class name is subclass, it extends the property of base class. Okay, you have to give the name of the base class. Yeah, let me see the example of polymorphisms. Sorry, yeah, polymorphisms as the same. Ability of object to take more than one forms. Let me see overloading. What is overloading? The overloading is a giving more than, we creating a more than one method with the same name, that is a overloading. Okay, so it means that like behavior is same, behavior may be differ, the name of the behavior is same. For example, sum, we are summing two numbers and then summing three numbers, it has to be give a features for the particular class. So that's why we are doing the method is overloading. And what it has on it has two constraints. When you are doing a overloading, you have to the variable, number of variable has to be differ as well as type of the variable has to differ. Okay, I am giving one example here. This method, class name is overloading. Here created object name is load. In this class having three method, but the three method name is same, that is sum. What is the difference? First and second, first one differ with number of parameter, and first and third it is differ with type of parameter. So okay, and for instead of that, if I am giving you another method public int sum integer A integer B, will it be overloaded? but I am changing the return type. Will it, it's not possible to, it's not comes under the overloading. So overloading is depends on number of, it has to differentiate with number of parameter as well as type of parameter, not with return type. Next one is the overriding. The overriding will be occur at the time of inheritance. So it means that when you want to give a definition, say in a, the, you want to differentiate the definition of the same behavior in a sub level as well as base level. Okay, for example, you are inherit the property of one class. So there is a subclass and base class. Base class have one method name is the expression. You just calculating, simply they take it as a sum. Okay, the method name is sum with the two parameter. Simply it will return the value is the sum of two variable. And in derived class have the same method, the same two parameter, but it want to give whatever the value it takes as a parameter, it has to sum with additionally the value 10 has to be added. So the behavior little differ, but the internal behavior is differ, the behavior is same, sum. So if you want to do so, that time the overriding will take place. So it means that when base class as well as derived class having the same method in a like a, even syntax also same, like number of variable, number of the type of parameter, if it is same, it means that that time the overriding will occur. I will give you an example here. So as already we seen, like overloading has one method, correct? The method name is sum. I am recreating sum here again, but without creating this, I can do the same functionality. I can invoke the, I can use the sum with the two variable integer, but here I want to change the internal behavior. Like I want to sum a plus b plus 10. The value will be get differ, like behave internal behavior is behave different with base as well as derived level. Okay. See the first one. What is happening in the first line of main? I am creating an object for same class or different class? Object for base class. Okay. If I invoke the method sum, what will happen? Will it invoke this method, the sum, which is written inside the overriding class? No, it will invoke the method of base class. After I am creating another object, that is write, it is creating object for overriding the same class. Okay, so it will invoke the same method. Okay, what is I, but in the reference I have declared both it both object referring the same base class object, correct? Overloading. So what is the, only the second part after new it is getting differ. What is it, why, what is, why it is differ? So what is the, like left side of equal and then what is the right side of equal to operator? What defines? So that is a, when creating an object, I want to define a class name, object name equal to new keyword, then I have to invoke the constructor, that is a, the class. So what is happening? I am asking in the third line, I am have declared overloading, the reference is overloading, but creating object for overriding. What it mean? Is it correct or wrong? So okay, instead of overloading, I am replacing with overriding. Will it correct? In third line, I am talking about third line. Instead of overloading, I am replaced with overriding. Will it be same? Same or different? So, will it execute? Okay, what is the difference? Sorry?
Second case?
Okay. The same class. Okay. Okay. For in this case, the sum will be invoked this within this class or base class. Base class or subclass. The third line I am asking, the fourth line, write dot sum, will it invoke the method of sum as sorry base class or derived class? How many of them telling it is will invoke base class? Base class. How many I am telling it is a invoking derived class, that is a overrided, overriding class method? Only one. Actually it will invoke the method of derived class. Actually what is object, where the object is created? New, after new, the using the new keyword is creating object. So here the object is created for overriding class, not a overloading class. That is write is write object write is referring the base class, that's all. It is only referring. I am come under the base class this level, that it's only referring the base level, but it's not creating the object for base level, it is creating object for derived level. Okay, only simply it's referring, that's all. Just I will execute, let me see. This is overloading, correct? It is visible, na? I am executing this overload class, overloading class. So it will print 7, 11.6, 13. Okay, accordingly the parameter I am passing. So I want to run override the same, correct? So let me change the value, then we came to know the difference. Okay, here what I am doing, first I am creating object for over loading, so it directly refers the base class, so definitely it will invoke the base class method sum. Next I am creating object for overriding, so it's supposed to invoke the method of same method inside the same class. So here what I have given a definition is, so whatever the value comes plus 10 it will get add. If it is invoking the base class, the result will be, what will be the result? If it is invoking base class, 13. If you are invoking derived class, it will be 23. The last one, what is the last one? Third invocation, I am passing 3 parameter. So what will happen here, first it is an object of derived class, so it will check whether the method is available in derived level. If not, what will happen? It will goes to base level. So base level have this method with 3 parameter, so that time it will invoke that thing. So it has to give the result as 7 23, then 17. Correct? It is not visible. It is okay, like console I can't increase the font. Okay. This I can, but I have to go in settings. So it gives the results. Yeah, you can trust me. Okay. Adding two values 7 and then adding values in overriding class 23, adding 3 value 17. So this is a, that's why you are, everyone is telling it's baseless. Okay. So it means that, oh yeah.
What is the
sorry? Actually, it will creating a memory for derived level only, but that it's like only referring. That's all. The reference we can use base as well as derived. There's not much difference. Why we are referring in base when you have multiple level of inheritance, not multiple level. In a base level we have so many classes. So many classes are there. So that time by using this reference we can easily go with another sub level. For example, it is a vehicle, it is a two wheeler and then it is a okay four wheeler. Okay, I am deriving here. So if I created only using two wheeler, so I can only access my access level is strict to this level. Okay, if I refer through base level, my accessibility level will be extend this much. Understood, na? So through that base level I can access all derived level. It will be helpful at the time of typecasting. Understood? Typecasting in the sense you have some method definition here and then method definition here. You have created an object for this but referred base level. You want to typecast, or you want to like access level has to be changed here. That time it will be helpful. If you are using only single base level, there is only one class, that is not much difference. In the base level, if there is more subclasses, then that time it will helpful. Yeah.
Sir, overriding class has a method to track, and overloading does not have a method to track. Now I have used this overloading write equals to new overriding. Can I refer write dot to track?
Sorry, I am not understood. I am not getting you.
It's overriding method.
Okay.
Overriding class has a method subtract.
Okay, subtract. Okay. Overriding having a subtract method.
But overloading does not have.
Overloading, okay.
And now I am referring overloading write equals to new overriding.
Okay. Yeah.
Now can I refer write dot subtract?
Yeah, you can. But it is object. This actually you are not. It is object level. Let me check. Yeah, it is not able to access if it is because it is referring to overload. So it can access. Just you understood, na? What actually I was tried here. What he is asked. So actually it is like, if I created the method subtract, but subtract is available in where? Derived class. In derived class, but I am referred to base class. So if I am referring, so it is leveling the same level, the base level as well as derived level in the same base level scope. So why here the sum is belongs to derived, but I can access it because I have overrided the base class method. So that's why it is working. For subtract it's not working because it is referring to base class. Sorry, derive base class, yeah.
Also
Sorry? Yeah, yeah, we can. Because it is x. This is actually base class. The this case, ride is referring to which one? Base. Okay, instead of overloading, you want to override. So you are telling that time you can't access three variable sum. You can access, not give, because it extends. So that is a feature. Like you are extending all property to derived class. Next one is a thread. Thread is a single flow execution. You can create thread by implements runnable runnable interface as well as thread class. Syntax is like class my thread extends thread. Okay. These are the five states involved in thread. One is a new states when you are like creating a thread, that time it will comes to new state. Okay. When you are invoking starts, start is a method to initiating the thread. So it will comes to the state runnable. After execution starts, so it will comes to, it is in a running state. Okay. If any like wait or sleep interrupt occurs, it will goes to blocked state. If the execution is completed, it goes to termination state. Okay. Okay. As I already mentioned, multi-threading. If you create, you can create multiple thread for the same class, so it will concurrently executes. Okay. And then synchronized. You feel that particular block of code has to be synchronized. It can, it if it the code, the block has to be accessed one by one. You have to use synchronized. Okay. Exception handling. So in a, when you running a program, there is a chance for having a exceptions. Okay. The particular case we can handle it. Particular case we cannot handle it. Okay. So if it is possible to handle, that is a exception. If it's not handled, that is an error. Okay. So the reason may be like user gives wrong input, for example divided by, for example I am taking two value, I am dividing the values. If you giving the value is 0, so at the time of execution only came to know we cannot divide by 0. So that time exception will catch and then do that action. If this is a hierarchy of exception, that is a first one is a throwable class, under that there will be chance of there is a error as well as exception. Error we cannot handle it. What is the, what are the chances of error? Syntax error, then the memory is now out of range, like JVM memory is like gone. So there is an error, we cannot handle it. The exception we can handle. The exception may be comes in two scenarios, at the time of compile, at the time of execution. At the time of compile, it is a compile time exception, another is a runtime exception. The compile time exceptions, so at the time of compile itself, the compiler will they inform you this is a chance of exception. The chances are there. For example, I am declaring one file, I want to read one file in a particular location, so it will tell you the file may not found because you may give wrong file name. So you have to handle that exception. So at the time of compile, it will tell you. And then IO exception, like divided by 0 may occur based on your expressions. So these are all some exception may happen for SQL database may not found. So those stuff, that is a compile time. Runtime is at the time of running your code, there is a chance. For example, you are creating an object, by using that object you are referring, you are working on method, but at the time of creating object, the object is null. So, but using that null, you cannot invoke any method. So there is a null, referring a null. So there is a null pointer exception also there, and then number format exception. So these are all some runtime exceptions.
Index out of bound, the if you are referring the limit other than the maximum, like array index out of bound. So these are all some exceptions in runtime. Okay, in exception handling, there is the three important terms are there. There is a try, catch, and then finally. Try is a block of code, the chances of having an exception. You feel that the particular code may have a chance to have an exception, that is has to be written in a try block. Then catch block, if the exception happened, what you have to do, the action, that is a catch block. Okay, based on the exception type, you can extend n number of catch blocks. Okay, then finally is not mandatory, it is optional, but it is like preferable to use when you want to close the database. Okay, so most of the you are developing a code, you definitely have to know this. Okay, when you are opening database in try block, definitely you have to close it in final block only. Why? For example, if you are opening a database, you have some code and then you are closing a database in a try itself. So what happened after open, you have written some code, if that code have an exception, what will happen? Without close, it will jump to catch. So database remain open. If the same code execute by n number of people in web, what will happen? Imagine number of like hit, it will be get unnecessarily database resource will be get wasted. Okay, so you have to close database in finally only, you have to use, it is mandatory. Okay, last one is a constructor. Like constructor, if you want to initialize value for an object, you can use constructor. Okay, I'll give you an example. The constructor name should be same as class name, you don't have a return type. Okay, you can use the constructor, even you can override the constructor. Okay, override in the sense you can write n number of constructor based on the same overriding, the constraints will be same here. For example, number of parameter and then type of parameter. Okay, these are some reference, you can refer it. I can share this PPT. Next one is a JSP. Okay, before getting into JSP, we talk about servlet. Okay, servlet is a same Java class, but it has the implicit HTTP request and response object. Okay, so it can handle the request and response, it come from HTTP. Okay, if you want to use, you have to extend the package javax.servlet. This is servlet. I will tell you architecture of servlet. For example, if you are giving a request from web browser, it will go through web server, it will be transferred to where? Servlet container. The servlet container having all the servlet classes. Based on the request type, it will send to the correspondent servlet. Okay, then if the servlet want database access, it will access it and then response will be sent back to web browser through web server. Okay, this architecture works in servlet. JSP, Java, what is it? Java server page. Okay, actually it is a HTML page with integration of Java code. Okay, HTML page integration of Java code, that is a JSP. It has to be, the file has to be saved in extension .jsp, and if you want to include any Java code, it has to be with the tag. This is a tag, you have to use it for including a Java code. Okay, this is a JSP environment. In this JSP execution environment, there is a two phases. One is a translation phase, another one is a execution phase. Translation, translation is like JSP code may or may not have a Java code, correct? Without Java code, you can write a JSP page. If the page having a Java code, so it has to be translated into class. Okay, so what is happening? The JSP page having a Java code, it will comes to translation phase. What will happen? It will translate to servlet. Okay, the code, whatever the code, it will be transferred to servlet. The servlet is like Java, again Java class. It will transfer to class by using compiler. Okay, using Java compiler, it will transfer to class file. That class file will be using JRE, Java Runtime Environment. It will transfer to the particular web page. It will go back to browser. If the page doesn't have Java code, directly it will comes to execution phase. It is like static content, correct? So there is no need to comes to translation phase. Java and then JSP having these three life cycles. One is the init, then service, then destroy. Init and service will be executed only once. Okay, init will be at the time of creation, destroy will be at the time of like end of the life cycle of the particular JSP or servlet. Service is a method, it will give the service like get, based on the get, post, whatever, it depends the service type. Okay, in JSP tag, as I mentioned, if you want to include the Java code in JSP page, you have to mention in the tag. It has a three type of tags in JSP. First one is a expression, then scriptlet, then declaration. Okay, the expression, if you want to do any expression and the result will be printed as it is, the result, if you want to print the result as it is in HTML page, you can use expression. The code we can call, another name is scriptlet. In the scriptlet, you can write the whatever statement you want, like condition statement, like looping statements, so whatever thing you want, you can use it. Then declaration, you can declare variable and methods, whatever you want, you can declare, but you have to use the proper tag accordingly. Okay, I will give you an example, then you came to know. This is an, I am using here the expression, simply I am printing the current date and time using the method date. It belongs to the package java.util. Okay, so what is happening? Simple HTML code. In the HTML code, I am writing one like string in a body, like hello, the time is now. So I am taking a current time using the Java method date. Okay, so it will print. Next one, scriptlet. Here what I am doing, I am combining Java code as well as HTML code. Here the first line is Java code, so I have written in where scriptlet. What I am doing here, I am taking a random number using the math class. Okay, using the method random, I am getting random number. If I am, the random number is less than 0, I will print hello, sorry, have a nice day. Else I will print have a good day. Okay, you have any doubts on this? No, how to use it? Simply you can use it as it is, like if condition for loop, and then you can combine in between both Java code as well as HTML code in a JSP page. Declaration, here I am declared one variable, that is a access count, that is an integer. Likewise, you can declare method also. Okay, if you want to declare an entire method like public void some print display or something, you want to declare a method, you can declare within this tag.
So, regarding declaration, then normally code, you can do it over there.
Yeah, you can do it. It's a prop. Actually, it is a proper way of accessing. it has some standard to access is a proper way, but you cannot declare a method. You can in a scriptlet you can declare a like variable, but here you can declare a method also, and then comment as it is. All the programming language have the comment. You can give a comment for give a description about the code. But there is a like we can use HTML comment also as well as JSP comment. There is a two difference. HTML comment will visible to the user, and then JSP comment it will not display to the users. So display in the sense it will not display in a web page. In web each web page you can see the source code. In source code it will not display the comment of JSP comment. Okay. Next one is the directives. It has a three directives: page directive, include directives, and then tag lib. Page directive is used to you want to like do any page actions, like you want to define a error page. If any error happened for the particular page, you want to navigate to error page. We can use it as less like you want to define the programming language. Then if you want to, I will give you an example, and you get more elaborated. These are the page directives. For example, here I am defining first one is a content type. I am giving the content type, whether it is a the pages content is HTML content or XML content, and then whether the page has to be flushed automatically or not. Then error page, if any error happened in the particular page, where it is supposed to be navigate. So the error page, it will, when error occur, it will navigate to error page. Then import, if you want to like import any predefined functions, not only this, if you want to use your existing class which is available, that method you have to refer in a JSP file, you can use it. For example, you have a Java class. In the Java class you have a methods. You want to use that method here, so first you have to import that classes. For import you have to use that tag. Okay, that is a page import equal to the class path. Next one is a page information. If you want to give a information about the page, you can give. Then session, whether you want to maintain a session in a page or not. Okay, I will give an example like session, all the things. The includes, simply it will include the pages. Mainly you can use this for header and footers. For example, in web pages you may use same header and footer in all the pages. Header and footer will be common in all the pages. You want to, no need to write the same code each and every page. Simply you can import those pages, header and footer pages, in all the pages. This is the accent tag. For accent tag is like it controls the servlet engine based on the action. For example, if you want to forward to some other page, you can use JSP forward, and then if you want to include, you can use JSP includes. But this include will be execute at the time of, it works at the time of execution time. But already we have seen include in a page, that is a, it will execute at the time of compiling. The param is a one action tag. If you want to navigate at the time of, for example, forward, if you are forwarding a page, that time you want to pass any parameter, you can use this tag with the name and value of the parameter. So this is a very important one in JSP. That is a JSP default object. Using this object, you can just more interact with Java code, as well as you can use more features in a JSP. First one is a request. It is a object of HTTP servlet request. For example, if you want to get request, it's a HTTP request. Okay. So HTTP request in the sense, if you are transfer one page to another page, at the time of navigating one page to another page, if you are passing any like parameter, you can get the value of the parameter using this request object. As well as you want to get the query string. What is a query string? For example, if you are invoking Google, okay, if you are searching any text in a text box, what is happening? The text will be passing as a query string. So it's like after cosine mark, it will give a variable name and then value. So that is called a query string. If you want to access that value, you can use request object. As well as you can get the URI of the particular page. As well as response is a object of HTTP servlet response class. For example, if you want to redirect, send direct to particular page, you can do. As well as you want to should not catch any data in a browser, you can use the content type, what kind of content, it's like HTML content or XML content, same you can use it. Session. What is a session? Are you knowing about session? It's very important. Session. Simple. When you are accessing a mail, session is occur. For example, when you are logging to the web service, till logout, one session is maintained. Okay. If the session is there, you can access inbox, you can draft a mail, you can whatever thing you want, you can do. After logout, the session will be get destroyed. You cannot access the same inbox after session is destroyed. So we are maintaining one session for the users. Okay. So for access scope, we are defining access scope for the particular application. Out, for example, you want to print any data in a JSP, you can use out.print, those stuff. Application, it is a servlet context, it is a object of servlet context. As already I mentioned, like servlet as a container, correct? So you want to access, using this object, all the servlet data you can access. That is a, what is the application object. And then exception, this is for error information, you want to use it for error information. Session objects, I will go with some detail about JSP session object. It's like a, I will give you an example. So yeah, before going to example, I'll tell you the important method involves in a session. The first one is a set attribute having a two parameter. One is the name of the parameter and the value of the parameter you're going to set. Okay, if you are set this value, you can access through your, till the session is destroyed, you can access this value anywhere in a web page. Okay, that is a session. If you want to access, you have to use the method get attribute. You have to pass the parameter as name of the parameter, session name. Then if you want to remove the session, you have to use session dot remove attribute. You have to pass the session name as a parameter. If you want to remove all the session variable for the user, you can use session dot invalidate. For example, if I am creating a name as a one session, again I am creating age as my another session, you want to destroy all the session, so you can use session dot invalidate, it will remove all the session. Yeah,
invalidate all the session variables or the entire session?
The entire session of the particular user. Each user have the session, own session. Only it destroy for the particular user. This is one example. See, I'm creating one HTML page. Okay, what I'm doing here, just I'm created one form. Inside form, there's a two input tag, one is a text, another one is a submit. Okay, when I'm doing action on submit button, the action will transfer to which page? In action, I have mentioned create session.jsp, simple HTML page with action. Whether it has any Java code, no. Okay, in create session, what I am doing? In body of the, I simply I have created one what? Session variable. The session variable name is what? My name. Just don't look into the first line. Okay, I'll explain it later why I'm using that. Okay, first I'm setting the session dot set attribute my name. The name value is, sorry. So first I have to explain. Sorry. Yeah. The first one is like I'm getting whatever action I'm perform, whatever the form field will be transferred to request object. Using that request object, I'm getting the name of the text box. Whatever value I'm entering, using this I can get the value. You can see it here. What is the name of name field of? What is the name of text field? My name. I'm using this name here to get the value inside the text box. So by using that value, I'm creating a session. But the session name is my name. Okay. After that, I'm redirecting to response. As I said already, by using response, you can redirect the page. So response dot send redirect. I'm redirecting to my session.jsp. This is a my session.jsp. Here, what I am doing, I am checking whether the session is available or not in this page. Okay, how to check? If I am getting, how to get the session variable? Get attribute name of the parameter. Okay, if it returns null, it means that session is not available. If gives any value, it is available. So I am checking if it is null. If it is null, what it has to do? It should not stay on this page. You simply redirect to login page. If session is available, I want to print the value inside the session. Okay. For example, I am simply typing this URL. Will it go? I am simply accessing without login page. I am accessing this page. Will it open? No. Why? I am not come through create session.jsp. In create session.jsp only I am creating a session. So I am direct, without that I am directly coming here. So it will not work. So this is how works in like mails, all the things. Like after logout, is it possible to go to inbox? No, because the session is destroyed. Okay. So if it is there, it will simply print the value with suffix, sorry, prefix welcome. Then after I have one anchor tag logout, as it will goes to logout.jsp. In logout.jsp, simply I am, what I am doing, removing the session using remove attribute, then redirecting to login.jsp. That is my session.jsp, na? Huh? This I am, before login I am trying to access this page. See what is happening. Redirecting to this page because there is no session. So this coming here. So I am in the same page, not a problem. So after logout, so it will come here. Again I am trying to access the page. So it will again go here. Sorry? Huh? We have done. In logout, see, no, for destroy you have to use, I am using remove attribute, see here, in this page, remove attribute in logout. So when there is an anchor tag, it will redirecting to this page. In this page, simply I am removing the session, then redirecting to login. This is application object. This application object, it has one feature, session can be shared by the single user. The application can be shared by all the user. Okay. For the application, for example, you have one web application. Okay. If you are created any session variable, the session variable belongs to the particular user who is created. Only one user can access that value. In application is not like that. For example, I am Rajavel. I am created one application variable. Okay. All the users using that application can share that value using the same name. Okay, that is a application variable. It is same like how we are creating a session, like set attributes, get attribute and remove attribute. Okay. here I am using it. Simply I am getting a one hit count. The variable name is hit count. I am checking whether it is null or zero. If it is null, I am printing welcome to my page. Then I am initialize the value as a hit count is 1. If already the value is set in application, it will print you the value welcome back to my website. Then increment the count, it will print the count value. Actually it's the last, it will go with 5 minutes only. Okay, I think already everyone, most of them knows about JavaScript. I will tell you only, it's very basic. Okay, it's like a JavaScript is a scripting language. It can be write inside a HTML. Okay, for handling a event, of if any heap event happen in a HTML page, it will be handled. It will execute in a browser. The code should come inside the tag script. Okay, and then with the attribute type. This is a client side validation. You can do client side validation. For example, if you have a form, whether the form value is empty or not, whether email is correct or not. So these are some user side validation. This validation you can use it, and then react based on the event. When you are doing any event, it can handle it, as well as you can read and write HTML element dynamically. Okay, and then you can handle the session using cookies. This is a sample script. I have written a inside body, I have created one parameter, like paragraph tag. After that, I'm mention a JavaScript. In this JavaScript, simply what I'm doing. This is before that I let you know, like get element by ID is a one method, belongs to the document. This is used to get refer any unique element by using his unique ID. Okay, so you can get the value inside that element as well as put some dynamic content on it by using get element by ID. So E, B as well as I should be capital. Okay, for referring the content of the paragraph, you have to use the attribute in a HTML. By using that, I am simply putting the current date. Okay, this date is JavaScript method. Okay, not belongs to Java. JavaScript also having a method, default method, that is date. It will print you current date and time. And then JavaScript can be anywhere in HTML. The best practice is to write in a header inside header tag, because it's easy to like debug the error, as well as we want to edit it and then you want to extend more. And external JavaScript, if you want, you can write separately JavaScript in a separate file. Okay, in this one, what you have to do, you have to create one JavaScript file. Inside you have to write all the methods belonging to JavaScript. Okay, that one you have to extend in a particular HTML page by using script, same attribute already mentioned, and then you have to give another attribute, that is a src. You have to mention the path of the particular JavaScript. Okay, and then simple thing like Java is semicolon is not mandatory, but best practice you can use end of the statement, you can use semicolon. By using semicolon you can write in single line itself n number of statement you can write. A simple comment is same like C, single line comment and then multiple line comment. Then these are the pop-up box available in JavaScript, that is a alert, confirm, then prompt. Alert is simply whatever the message you are giving inside alert, it will alert. Confirm, it will give you the same, but it has the two button. One is, what is that? Yes, sorry, okay and cancel. If you press okay, it will return the value is true, else false. If you press cancel, it will return false. Okay, so if you want to do any action based on the button press, you can get that value using confirm, but alert box will not. and then prompt, it will print you message with one text field. Whatever you are entering to text field, that one will return back. Okay. So for example, here prompt, please enter your name. If I enter any name, so it will, you can get it based on that. You can use that name for your further action. See, this is simple. Like in body, I have created two button. One is a alert confirm prompt. On click of each button, I am invoking the method I am alert, I am confirm, and I am prompt. In alert, simply alert message. Confirm, I am checking the return value. If it is yes, simply I am printing the return value. Then prompt, same, it will print the return value also. These are some common used event, on load. So event, so event is like, for example, if you want to at them of event, for here one event is there. What is that event? For the button on click, on click is an event. At the time you want to do any action, you can do. Here what we have done, simply display some alert messages. So likewise, you can do based on event, you can do the action. So these are some common event. On load, the few pages loading is on load and unload, as well as on focus. If any like event is focused, the element is focused, for a text field is focused, when you move to the you are any for if you go to the particular text box, that is focused. You come, you go to another text box, that is blur. So blur is like focus out. Okay. On change, if you are changing any value, this on change, submit, and then mouse over, mouse down, mouse out, on error, key down, key up, and so these are some events. You can do any action on this event. I give you some example. What is this required field validation? So if you want to get the value of the text field, what you have to do? Get element by id, id name, and then value. I am checking that value is empty or null. If it is, if so, then what I have to do? First enter the first name. First name must be filled out, and then I am returning here email. What is the email? Email supposed to have two special characters. What are they? Dot and at the rate. Okay, and then it has to be appear in the particular location. At the rate should be after some text. After at the rate also, there should be some text before dot. Okay. So what I am doing, I am getting the position of particular characters, those characters, getting the value which is entered in the text box. Then after, I am getting the index of at the rate as well as dot. That is, I am taking the last dot index. Okay, because in a before at the rate also, I can give a email ID with dot. Okay, so here I am checking if at position is less than 1. So it means that the email ID start with at the rate. It is a not valid. Next condition, dot is less than at position plus 2. So what it mean? Dot position is appearing, like it may appear followed by at the rate or after one character. That it mean that I am telling, I am fixing the like limitations, like after at the rate there should be minimum 2 characters should be there before dot comes. Okay, then another condition, what are they? The email ID should not end with dot. Okay, at least it should be after dot, it should be 2 character. If so, if any of the condition is not satisfied, it will print not a, so if it is satisfied, it is not a email ID. Then cookies, you can store the locally some data in your machine, that is a cookie. So DOM is a document object model. By using that, you can dynamically create an element and then remove the element, and then you can timely put content, get the content, all this stuff you can do with document object model. Okay, for example, just as we said before, like using, if you want to put any data inside any div or paragraph, you can use get element by ID, then you have you can use inner HTML. As well as you want to find number of the element for number of images in a page, you can use document dot images dot length. So these are some document. By using document object, you can do all the stuff dynamically. You can set the document title as well as get the document title. This is the last one, CSS on JavaScript. You dynamically you can you may aware of CSS, cascading style sheet. What is the use of this? You can design your page like with n number of styles, like changing the colors, then size of the elements, all this stuff. You can dynamically do with document object model. For example, here I am changing the background color of the particular element. I am referring the element by document.getElementById, then the attribute, there is a main attribute here, that is a style. It defines the style of the particular element. What is the property we are using? The attribute, like background or font or display. Based on that, we can change the stuff. I will share all the PPTs with you. You can refer it, and then if you have any doubts, you can mail it.